Hey everyone, busy this week, so we're just gonna have one of those special videos where I talk more personally about things. So yeah, where are we in the world? 2020 has really been the weirdest year I've ever experienced, but then again, I'm not really that old yet. Good news is on the horizon though, vaccine trials are going smoothly, about 9 or 10 in phase 3, I don't remember. There's even one phase 3 trial with about 25,000 participants. That's an insane amount and is much more than what an average phase 3 trial normally requires. So yeah, things are going smoothly and pretty much as expected. To be honest, sitting at home has made me go a little bit crazy, but it's for the good of the world. Man, looking at all those people walking outside has really made me think, people really stopped giving a shit about this virus. You know when a new virus appears, everyone gets super scared of it, and now it's like, meh. I do sometimes wish people would value the lives of other people and their own lives a little more. But yeah, I don't know everyone's situation, so I won't say much more. I will say that if the president can get this disease, so can you. A little more caution can't hurt. I'm looking at you, college students planning on going on Halloween parties. Be like me and buy some candy and eat it alone at home. It's the cool thing to do these days. I got a pack full of Kit Kats in my living room ready to go. And also some Skittles from last Halloween. Sorry guys, this video is going to be a bit short and a bit of a ramble. Our clinical trials have been picking up lately and I've hardly had any time to myself. That's why I haven't been on social media at all. Feels like I'm kind of falling out of the loop. This madness will probably go on for at least another month, which got me thinking a bit on if this is a good time to be taking a small break from YouTube. I say that, but realistically, it's probably not happening. What I'm actually saying is that there might be a few more of these types of videos in the next month or so, where I just ramble about things. But yeah, anyway, I haven't actually prepared any content for today, so I'm kind of just making things up as I go. Sometimes I go on YouTube and look at conspiracy and pseudoscience channels just for fun. You know, to see what they're up to, and also to look for more content to make. But sometimes I wish I don't do that because it just makes me angry. I look back at Computing Forever and he's still making videos trying to convince people not to wear masks and take basic precautions. I mean, seriously, how do you talk about a single topic for so long and not get tired of it? And YouTube is a scary place that reinforces echo chambers. If you scroll through the comment sections of his videos, it's full of idiots who don't know a single thing about science, claiming that masks are ineffective or an oppression of society. How low of an IQ do you have to believe that, seriously? And then watching Computing Forever just continuously spew his bullshit around, putting the lives of others at risk. I mean, ultimately, this is the type of stuff that will push humanity closer to the fire. And I'm not just talking about his videos on the pandemic. I'm a full supporter of free speech, but it's times like these where I feel like you should at least have an IQ test before making commentary videos on YouTube. It's kind of like standing on the wrong side of history. You know, in your classes, you always learn about these bad people and stuff. If we ever have a story like that centuries into the future, Computing Forever would probably be on that side, especially for topics like climate change, for example. Honestly, I wouldn't mind if he had a smaller following, but each of this guy's videos gets views in the tens of thousands. It doesn't sound like a lot on YouTube since you guys are all probably watching videos with millions or at least hundreds of thousands of views, but imagine the physical bodies of like 50,000 people. Just a few hundred people in an auditorium is a large amount. Now imagine 50,000, all listening to this guy spew nonsense and agreeing with him. My god. But anyway, that's why I believe we need to make more debunking channels out there. There are just way too many channels that spread false information, which could potentially harm people. So we need more channels that go out there and fact checks everything. If you're thinking about making a new debunking channel, there's never a better time. Personally, I think starting a YouTube channel on any topic is a good idea, but even better if you can join the forces of skepticism. So yeah, now that I've gotten all of that out of the way, we can talk about some updates regarding the pandemic. Yes, like I mentioned, we got some good vaccine candidates right now that show quite a bit of promise. Getting a vaccine approved in the next couple of months seems very doable now, but of course, distributing it is another concern. If you're young like I am, you probably won't get to touch one of those needles until a while later. Yeah, you're gonna have to wear those masks and stay indoors just a little bit longer. I'm sorry to be the one to break the news to you. But then again, maybe we'll have super high production rates depending on which vaccine we want to distribute. I guess it will depend. Another bit of research came out recently that says you may be more susceptible if you have certain Neanderthal genes. Very weird, isn't it? A recent genetic association study identified a gene cluster on chromosome 3 as a risk locus for respiratory failure upon SARS-CoV-2 infection. A new study comprising 3,199 hospitalized COVID-19 patients and controls find that this is the major risk factor for severe SARS-CoV-2 infection and hospitalization. Here, we show that the risk is conferred by a genomic segment of about 50 kilobases that is inherited from Neanderthals and is carried by about 50% of people in South Asia and 16% of people in Europe today. Well, not like this information is going to do you much good since you probably don't know what your own genes look like. I should probably get my genes sequenced. It's weird that I deal with DNA so often in my studies and yet I don't know the composition of my own genetic information. But I don't recommend everyone to take the test out, such as computing forever, because you'd probably find an extra chromosome in the results somewhere. Anyway, this kind of sparks a new interest in me. Recently, I've been learning a bit on machine learning applications, and this most certainly is something that perhaps we could identify higher risk factors using machine learning algorithms. Well, the authors of this paper didn't, but it's a good option for future studies, perhaps. Oh, another new research that came out gave some pretty good evidence that face masks significantly decrease the release of respiratory droplets. Homemade masks out of cloth, however, were not nearly as effective. The COVID-19 pandemic triggered a surge in demand for face masks to protect against disease transmission. In response to shortages, many public health authorities have recommended homemade masks as acceptable alternative to surgical masks and N95 respirators. Although mask wearing is intended in part to protect others from exhaled virus-containing particles, a few studies have examined particle transmission by mask wearers into the surrounding air. Here, we measured outwards transmission of micron-scale aerosol particles by healthy humans performing various expiratory activities while wearing different types of medical-grade or homemade masks. Both surgical masks and unvented KN95 respirators, even without fit testing, reduced the outward particle transmission rates by 90% and 74% on average during speaking and coughing, respectively, compared to wearing no mask, corroborating their effectiveness at reducing outward transmission. These masks similarly decreased the outward particle emission of a coughing super emitter, who, for unclear reasons, emitted up to 2 orders of magnitude more expiratory particles via coughing than average. In contrast, shedding of non-expiratory micron-scale particulates from friable cellulosic fibers in homemade cotton fabrics masks found confounded explicit determination of their efficacy at reducing expiratory particle emission. Audio analysis of the speech and coughing intensity confirmed that people speak more loudly but do not cough more loudly when wearing a mask. Further work is needed to establish the efficacy of cloth masks at blocking expiratory particles for speech and coughing at varied intensity to assess whether virus-contaminated fabrics can generate aerosolized formities. But the results strongly corroborate the efficacy of medical-grade masks and highlight the importance of regular washing of homemade masks. So there it is, N95 masks are incredibly effective. Homemade cloth masks, however, are a little iffy, so I wouldn't recommend them if you can get an N95 or even just a regular surgical mask. Anyway, I'm recording this video on the 4th of October, but more news may have come out since then that I would find worthy of sharing. If I remember, I'll update some of them in the description below. I know it's difficult to keep up with these studies, so it's easier if someone does that for you. I do the same for certain political issues, so I understand the feeling. Okay, so I'll end my rant here. Sorry for another one of those low-effort videos, but hopefully I'll get out a proper debunk next week. This study is literally making me pull my hair out. I can't say this to my coworkers or the hospitals we work with, so I'm gonna say it here. If there's anything I learned about working in clinical trials, it's that there are only certain people you can trust. The vast majority of them, you can't even expect them to do their jobs. And some of them do it so badly that it could potentially ruin a huge part of the study. Whew, feels good to get that off my chest. I'm gonna shut up now before I say something I regret. Okay, bye.